All right. I'd like to welcome everyone to this event, and thank you so much for coming. Barbara Hart has had an incredible career here at the Muskie School, and I shouldn't say it in a way that kind of implies that it's over. Barbara's going to be working as a consultant on a project with us, we want to kind of mark this transition with this kind of event honoring Barbara's work to date, let me put it that way. I want people to know that this event is being recorded, so if you were apt to kind of make some like shout out some remarks, make them appropriate remarks. But we welcome those good appropriate remarks. So anyway, we're gonna be posting this up on the web because there were several people who were unable to be here from distance and far away. And anyways, I'm gonna turn the program over here in a second to Chris Ahanchik, who's the director here at the Butler Institute. But I wanted to read a couple of remarks that people sent in advance of people who couldn't be here. This is one short set of remarks from Ginger at OVW. And she wanted Barbara to know that all of the folks at OVW wish her the very best in her retirement. Her contributions to the work we support are so many, and she's had a tremendous influence on the way people doing this life-saving work, i.e. our grantees and beyond, understand DV, helping them to know what to do in response to it. And she goes on to say, Barbara has been a steadfast leader and a visionary in shaping the movement to end violence against women. Her work has made the voices of battered women heard and resulted in lasting change in so many communities. Please let her know that OVW is grateful for her life's work and her tireless commitment. And then, for those of you who might not understand the nuances of our work here at Cutler, is Elizabeth Snell is the director of our Violence Against Women Measuring Effectiveness Initiative. And Elizabeth, as some of you may know, is pregnant right now, and she's had some complications in her pregnancy and can't be with us today, and she was really crushed not to be able to see you in person, Barbara. But so she wanted to share some comments as well. And I'm Elizabeth says, dear all, I'm writing this from the prenatal care unit at MMC, where I have a lovely view of the White Mountains and the law school. I am fine, albeit bored, and my pregnancy is fine, but there have been a few minor complications that will keep me here until the birth. I'm imagining a room full of former and current colleagues, mentors, partners, friends, and other inspiring figures who have been a part of this movement over the years. How I wish I could be there to say hello to you all and to celebrate Barbara in person. I know that the VAWA MEI team will do both on my behalf with their usual warmth and gusto. And she goes on to say, Barbara, I am grateful to you for so many things, like your perspectives and your humor, and I'm particularly appreciate how you modeled for me how to ask why when others might not even think to raise the hard questions. I'm so glad we were able to overlap at Muskie for 18 months. Thank you for bringing this work to Maine, and know that we will do our best to make you proud of the project you, Anita, and others established. By the way, my due date is January 20th, Inauguration Day. How soon shall I send my firstborn to you for a lesson in living a life of social justice?
So this is both a sad and happy occasion, because I think we're celebrating Barbara's work. I think that it's sad for us, because even though she's going to be doing some work, she's not going to be doing as much as she has done through the years. And I decided, this is going to take a few minutes, because what I did was I went looking back. I'm so happy Anita St. Alicia's here, because I went back looking for some notes when Barbara made a guest appearance in class that we taught. And this is long, long ago, 2004. And I saved the notes. And you should know, I am not a hoarder. I saved them, actually, because they meant a lot to me in terms of some of the things that Barbara said. And I think, you know, people always talk about when you're teaching that you, you know, you learn more than you are actually teaching. And I'm going to share something that I learned from her. I think more, and I just want to go back to 2004. If anyone remembers 2004, this is, you know, Nicholson versus Capetta, and Barbara had was with the Pennsylvania Coalition, and Anita and I were doing work on some court evaluations, and also on the our National Child Welfare Resource Center, my works in child protection. And the thing that Barbara really focused on, and this was a thing for me that I really thought about, is she really talked in two different levels. And it was that idea of, what are you doing in the macro system? And then what are you doing in the micro, like really on the personal level? And how does the experience from the personal level really define the policies and the approach that you have on the macro level? And I think in America, there's this tendency to really address the symptoms of the problem. And I think that Barbara really reminded me, and this was, you know, I was entrenched in my world in child welfare, and she continues to do this, in all, if you think about this in all the work that she does, is to remind us that you need to address the real catalyst of the problem, and the solutions are really need to be focused on that rather than the symptoms. And I have my notes, and I have to tell you, this is really for me. It was thinking, spotting the problem, really focusing on, you know, what is the foundation, the analysis and the barriers, and then the response in terms of not just how you respond in a simplistic way, but a comprehensive, holistic way. And then reassessing what your response was, and did it really have the impact you hoped it would have. But that really wasn't, in some ways, the big conclusion for me. Because the big conclusion, and these were the notes that really meant the most to me, and on the personal level, is the questions that she asked were, what will bring justice? What will call you back to hope? And what can we do to help? And I think that, for me, has really defined when I think of policies and programs and, you know, all of that, it really goes back in the end to those questions. And I always think about, what can I do to help? So with that, I hope that you learn as much as I learned many years ago. And I thank you for being here.
Thank you. I'm going to move you around because standing still sometimes is problematic for me. I'm going to be sitting down. If you can't hear me, I can belch really loudly. I have to tell a story on myself. I tried very hard to get a dental appointment before I came here because my upper plate is somewhat loose. And as a consequence, I have a little lisp. And my greatest fear is, in the middle of talking, I will lose my upper plate, which will make it much more problematic than a lisp. They weren't able to fit me in until the 19th, but I couldn't ask to come back the evening of the 19th to do this, so please bear with me. I want to start out by thanking people. Oh, you know, one of the things we didn't do was we didn't do this. So I have to figure this out very quickly. That didn't do it. Maybe my technical assistance provider can tell me what how to move this. Was it maybe this? That's a bell. Just to wake you up, I guess.
What?
Okay. I'm just the left side.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Thank you. Okay, so I want to start by thanking everybody that's here, and this is amazing. One of the things that we might want to do is, if some of you know some of the people, a couple of you may know all of the people, but I doubt that. And so as I go through the thanks, and if I mention work that I've done with you, if you would kindly stand so that people can know what you've done. I'm not going to introduce you. But maybe if people are interested in that work, they can come over and talk to you later. Because you are a group of people with such incredible passion and vision and hope at a time of great challenge to hopefulness. And I think it would be great if you would know each other. So, and then there are going to be people who I, or programs that I don't mention, like ACLU. I'm testing you now.
Okay, science.
We all need a little tutorial. That was the instruction, and you followed it perfectly. I said I was going to talk louder sometimes. Okay. And so when I mention your organization or work that we've done together, if you would kindly stand, and then afterwards maybe you can check for those. So I want to start by saying many thanks to Krista Hunchick and Anita, who I think is right here. for bringing me to Muskie almost 10 years ago. I'm grateful for the opportunities that Cutler and Muskie have brokered for me. It's been an honor to be a part of the VAWA MEI initiative. Thank you all. My awareness of the research on violence against women has grown exponentially during these 10 years. I truly enjoyed writing, although some of you may question this, periodic summaries of the most significant research on intimate partner, sexual assault, dating violence, and stalking for the Office on Violence Against Women's director. In no small way has the research that I have been able to do by working with you, it's really informed other work. I mean, it's, all these things fit together, don't they? So, the work that I do here certainly informed work that I did monthly in terms of webinars with Veterans Justice Project, which some of you know were and hopefully still will be discourse between researchers and practitioners about sort of cutting edge work that we're doing in the country. The work here also informed the work that I did with with Andy Klein in the National Bulletin on Prevention of Domestic Violence. I write a legal column and I write a legacy column, and I get to spread some little research in there from time to time. And so this has informed that work as well. In addition, Andy and I wrote a piece for the National Institute of Justice. And I'm going to have to read the title because I, of course, never remember it. It's a stupid title. Practical Implications. Oh, excuse me. I'm going to take it, aren't we? This will be a problem. But for the people who will watch this, for the people around the country who know me, they will be absolutely delighted. I think it's fabulous that this is the worst that I'm going to do. Nasty comments. Okay. The name is The Practical Implications of Current Intimate Partner Violence Research for Victim Advocates and Service Providers. And it was a massive tome, and it was a pleasure working with Andy. There are so many other wonderful places to review research now that I think it's in no small, it's to our credit, that there is decent, understandable, accessible to the layperson, the non-researcher person, research on this issue, so that we can avoid being called factoid users. We can actually be those who use research in a way that's informed and compelling. And although I don't think I agree with one of my colleagues here that what is called evidence-based is always subject to question from my perspective, as I read things and they tell me how evidence-based it is, I think, you know, it's not any more evidence really, usually, in my own experience, but that's been my feeling all of my life, which is not to say that I think researchers are flawed, but that researchers provide me some confirmation. And it's always great to have confirmation. And when I don't get confirmation, then I let it get into conflict, and that's good, because I enjoy that as well. Anyway, so I have worked here also with the Tri-County Advocacy Project. Thank you all for standing up, which is a partnership between Muskie and law school, and our absolutely wonderful partners in Lewiston, which are the Sabres and Safe Voices and United Somali Women of Maine and PTLA and ILAP. It's a great consortium. I think it's one of the best in the lab grant. It's just, I think it's really excellent. So you have made that, I mean, you know, it's hard for lawyers to sit only and talk research, I have to confess, and obviously I don't. But to have the opportunity to see the work that you're doing and to see how you have and are transforming that tri-county area is very wonderful. Okay, so moving on, I have to thank Attorney General Janet Mills and Lisa Marchese and Susan Fuller and Holly. Where are you, Holly? And anybody else that worked on the Maine Domestic Abuse Fatality Review Panel? Julie, I can see you there. Yes, I'm sorry. Okay, there you are. So there are lots of you here. And I don't know if name everybody because it'll take the whole time that I probably don't have. And then I appreciate the work that I did with Eva on doing training of the GALs here in the state. And I hope that Maureen and others will get to continue to do that training and work with Nicole on the Paris project, which was a project where we tried to retrieve guns, trying to get systems to do a better job of retrieving guns from batterers. So thank you, Nicole. And then, in addition to that, I worked a long time ago on the BEST project, which is Building Economic Security for Survivors. And if there's anything, thank you. My paths have crossed. I even remember sitting there thinking about bringing this to the Violence Against Women Measuring Effective Initiative here. And when I was meeting with Catherine Pearson, it was one of the best brainstorming dinners that we had forever. Anyway, and Building Economic Security for Survivors is something that we started because I really care about creating economic stability for women. And it's in such jeopardy. And it was a beginning, and I hope that you all can pick that up again at some point and really work on all the pathways to economic security that are needed by women in this state and beyond. Then I get to work every year the Mary Byron Foundation in Louisville, Kentucky, has a project called Celebrating Solutions, in which they award four small awards each year to some of the most innovative and reputable programs to end violence against women. And some of these are very small programs, and this year the ones I reviewed were largely rural, and I wrote to them and said I was so pleased to see that there were rural finalists because we can almost get nobody to think that a rural model is something that they ought to invest their money in so that we can in fact provide equal justice for people who live in isolated and rural communities. So anyway, hopefully at least two of those four will be rural places. And then I'll just thank the rest of you in the room that who I have missed, and there's other work that I've done, but there's only so much time. And then for the people out there in the world, you're going to be pissed because I'm not going to almost mention you at all. And this is really the work that I've done since coming to Muskie and that I'm thanking people for now. I would thank that other people for the work before me. And I thank George also for being one of the most thoughtful and kind shepherds of justice work in my experience. So thank you for doing that here at Cutler and for the work that you do in Maine. I think it's extraordinary. Thank you for deciding this was going to be a go, which was kind of fun for me to dabble on here. And for Allison, for all the work that you put in. Oh, there you are, back there, in making this happen, and Susan Fuller for the cake, for all things sweet, as per usual. Thank you. Okay, so I was going to talk about some stuff, substantively, too. Today I want to talk to you about learning and knowledge and the ways I have, the way how I acquire knowledge, and I know it's the way that you acquire knowledge as well, but it's just to go back and do some reflections with you on the lessons learned that have helped me be a decent advocate, attorney, activist, and less of an agitator these days than I wish I was, and that I used to be, but then in this institution, and that's not exactly a major function of the institution, Chris and I learned that, so I did pretty well in terms of sitting on my agitator. So, the one thing that is really, we should also note that we're sitting in the Osher later, well, I have it written down here because I was going to get it wrong, Lifelong Learning Institute. And for me, it's just important to say that, in fact, I learned at Muskie in many ways that learning does start and go at least from birth to death. And so I appreciated the learning that I have been privileged to experience over the course of the last 10 years, almost here. So let us talk about the multifaceted nature of knowledge and learning. As you all read, I'm not a scholar, and I am a perpetual student. I have looked to knowledge ultimately in many ways, and one of them I want to talk to you about is experiential, because I think it's been the most profound learning process for me in my over 72 years. But as you, I have learned in many ways, listening, engaging in criticism, self-criticism, confrontation, reading, writing, researching, networking, and revisiting truth. And I think that it's something that is important for all of us, even the younger ones of us, to revisit the truths that we hold to be self-evident, and we need to explore further and figure out how to make sure that those truths are solid and they move forward. So, stories about my learning. This is probably a redundant thing, so, but it's true. I want to just, you can read these. I'm in an institution where PowerPoints are usually filled with words that are so small that you can't see things because people are putting out their research on these. And this is just a crib sheet for me, but hopefully one that you can see. I really think that experiential learning is the most profound that I've had, and it is extraordinarily engaging, often for me uneven, and sometimes it's just totally unmanageable, and I don't know what to do with it. Poverty was one of the first things that I learned about. I was 7 years old, and my father began something called Faith Sunday School in downtown Detroit, in a little circle park that was within throwing distance from the large and most powerful businesses in the city, and it was probably the most impoverished part of town. It was isolated by expressways and these large buildings, and some of the most disenfranchised, marginalized people lived in that neighborhood. We would go down to this park, and it was started in the summertime, and I grew up at a Baptist church, and if any of you ever attended a Baptist church, they sing boisterously and loudly, and off-key most of the time, but with great enthusiasm. And so my father and I, he was a song leader at our church, we would sing. And when you sing and create unconventional, conspicuous happenings, children come, curious. Children came, and then their parents came, and we had this really lovely, hopeful community of very destitute people that met every Sunday. And as winter came, we had to think about closing it down because couldn't be eating in the park. It's colder in Michigan than it does here, even colder than today. So we looked. My great uncle found an old storefront building and looked it over, and it looked like it was on the park, and so we needed to be there, very close to part of the community. Unfortunately, the basement was filled with 3 feet of water that was stagnant and toxic, and had to be cleaned out. The walls were perspiring, as they do in many places like this. The only heat source was an old stove with just the top burners, a gas stove, But my uncle sort of reclaimed this building, restored it, and by the time winter came along, we were able to continue the Sunday school, and then in the wintertime, we began to do home visiting in all the families that participated in the Sunday school. And their houses, their homes, were much like the storefront before it was reclaimed by my great uncle. Terrible, terrible places where these women and children lived. And this was in a time between food stamps, between the first food stamp program during World War II and the second one that happened in the 60s. So there were no food stamps, there was no health care. After World War II, women who had been employed very well during the war lost their jobs, they lost their union cards, and in Detroit, the only way to any kind of financial stability was through a union card. So these women were thrust back into a situation with absolutely no safety net, no child support. And so we began to figure out ways to bring them the kinds of resources that they needed in order to survive, not to thrive, unfortunately, but to survive. And my experience with poverty there was so profound that at first I was blaming the mothers for these terrible circumstances until my father challenged my truth and helped me understand that this was my father's Republican. This was a morally bankrupt society that placed these women and children in this destitute position, and it was our responsibility to make sure that the society removed these gross inequities. And we have done such a poor job. Anyway, that was my learning about poverty. My next learning was about sexual abuse. I tried many learnings in between, like school, so I learned that stuff too. But in terms of profound learnings, I was about 13. I was going down to the Art Institute on the city bus every week, and one day, as I was coming back, I got on the bus pre-packed. I squeezed myself into the back row. This man squeezed himself in next to me. Shortly, he hit the end of my knee. I knocked it off. Then his hand was on my leg, and I knocked it off again. And when he kept pressing at me, I leapt over him, and he ran his hand up between my legs. And I went to the front of the bus, sat right down next to the bus driver, because I figured if I needed a helper or a protector, he could probably do it. And then I watched the man. I watched him until he got off the bus, because I was going to go past my bus stop if he didn't get off the bus before me and at a safe distance. And so he got off the bus, fortunately, and so I was then able to get home, talk to my mother, describe to her what had happened, and she asked me to reflect on what I did that day to protect myself. And so I told her about how I had leapt over him, and that I used my body, and that I had gone and found myself a protector, and that I had been put him under surveillance, and that I made sure that he was long gone before I put myself back into any risk. And she commended me for my strategies. She also told me that I was not to blame for what happened to me. And then she turned to me and she said, there is a strategy that you didn't use, that I'm surprised that you, of all people, didn't use. And I said, what's that? And she said, your big mouth. And she said, you know, you scream for justice all the time. You yell for justice in many ways, in many places, in many venues, even at 13. Why didn't you yell then? And I said, two reasons. One, I was afraid. And two, I was embarrassed. I was afraid that the people would do to ridicule me, and so I didn't speak up. And she commended me and suggested to me that we needed to think of other strategies, including shout-outs, and that I probably then needed to rehearse these things in my head so they would come to me easily when if the situation or something like it would happen to me. So my father got home, and my mother and I told him what happened, and my father said, you'll never ride the bus again. My mother looked at him and said, no, that's not an acceptable solution. She did all of these things to protect herself. And we are not going to ask our daughter to isolate herself in order to be safe. It's a false promise of safety. We have to help her and commend her for her wisdom in this instance and help her develop more strategies so that she's able to cope with other of these unfortunate and too often occurring circumstances. It's not on my, but I just thought of, you know, sometimes when you grow up right after World War II, you hate Germans. I did. I lived in a neighborhood where we didn't go by any VWs, and we were never going to go to Germany, and blah, 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 blah. And then, of course, it turns out that I married a German woman who was an immigrant that came over here after World War II at about the age of 13 with her mother, who had lived through World War II and who had run from the Russians with many, many other women who were running from Russians because one of the spoils of war is sexual use and abuse of women. And she spent about 2 years trying to find a place that was safe where she and her daughters, because this was before Corey was born, she and her two young daughters were at risk of being raped still and by the occupation forces, not just the Russians. So as we think about the incredible sexual violence that's happening in the Middle East right now, as the spoils of war and as a method of war, it breaks my heart, and I think that the lessons that we learned about stranger danger are so limited, and I hope that we are teaching our children, sons and daughters, about the danger that is available, is occurring here and is occurring there, and the strategies, that, including the females, need to show out and talk about this appalling behavior. Okay, third is guns. And I thought that we were going to have Margaret Drogan here, and this would make it.
She's right there.
She is here. I can't see anything. It's just whatever. So Margaret.
Hi. We just didn't stand up.
A gun person, along with Nicole, and certainly Susan, and others I'm sure in this room. I'm jumping ahead a decade when I was battered, as many of you know, by Lawrence Baldwin, mid-20s. And I say his name when I do talks about my being battered because I think that it's just important. It's ethically necessary for me to out him every time I mention being battered. Not that you know him, not that you remember, except that he was the guy who battered me for about 2 years. Anyway, we were at his mother's house for dinner, and he said he wanted to have a private conversation with me in the back room, and so I went, and he started hitting me in the head, knocked off my glasses, and I used my loud voice because I was in a house with, you know, people that cared for me, and his mother immediately came back, and she told him to stop it. He didn't stop, and so as he continued, and he was lunging around her in order to get to me, she told her daughter to run and get the gun, the handgun, the pistol that was in her bedroom, in that little, those of you who did tally reviews can probably finish the sentence, in the little, I can't find the words, in the little desk that was right next to the bed, in that little drawer where all of those pistols are, and they're kept, not safely, but anyway, Temperance was able to get the gun, brought it back, his mother held the gun to his chest, told him she would shoot him. If he continued to do this, he kept advancing on her. She called her son, who got him out of there. And then I got out of there safely with the help of his sister. But I began then to reflect on what had happened, and I realized that had his mother used that gun, I would have been so heartbroken, but she would have not been able to live with herself, with the fact that she had used her gun and injured or even killed her son. I also realized that the gun might not have just killed Lawrence. It could have been turned on Mildred herself, or any of the rest of us, and that I had never seen a gun up close and personal before that, I have to acknowledge. And I was afraid of it, but I was much more afraid of what would happen to that family if somebody was killed because of me and the use of a gun. So I determined that I was never going back to that house or to see him again, and I didn't. Because it was not a situation that I was willing to put them in or myself once again. So since that time, I've participated in zillions of things relating to getting guns from batterers and from other dangerous people, and certainly will continue to do that until the day I die. Get the guns, I say. I appreciate it, for those of you who participated, and I think that the law school that co-sponsored the forum over at Whitman, Karen and I were there, to listen to very interesting speakers talking about removal of guns in order to create safety in our homes and families. Okay, next thing. So intuition is inextricably linked with more substantive kinds of knowledge. And for me, and this is also the point of this is also to say, listen to the voices of better women, listen to the voices of survivors. We learn so much more than we thought we knew by listening to the things that they have to tell us in terms of their truths. So I was practicing law, and a woman called and said, I've got a student today, I just got a protection order, he's going to kill me, and I need you to help me so that I don't get killed. I arranged everything. She came over and she said, you have to help me. And I said, well, you've got a protection order. And she said, no, I have to do other things. It's not enough. I've got to do something to make sure he doesn't kill me. Now, in my world now, it is that I see this as I have to implement this order. There's a piece of paper that needs to be implemented. I need to do something to make sure that it works. And I need you to help me because I can't do this by myself. That's what you, as an attorney, that's what I'm asking you to do. And so I said to her, it's going to be hard for me to convince the cops and everybody, his lawyer, who happened to be their family lawyer, that he is this nice, sweet, wonderful deacon, is likely to be a killer. And so I need to have information from you. So tell me why you think he's going to kill you. And so she began a story that I extracted about 10 points from, taking notes. The first thing she told me was that she had told him that she was getting a divorce, the differences were truly irreconcilable, and that she had looked for housing in the immediate neighborhood, in the school district, so that she didn't have to disrupt the kids' schooling. And this was a very middle-class suburban, whatever, with not many rental places. So he went to all of the landlords that he knew that were renting, and he told them that she was a whore and that she was a terrible housekeeper and she was a rotten mother and she was a spendthrift and sort of any of the many other ways that you malign women, men, but mostly women. And the local landlords refused to rent to her. And I thought, what a creep. But a question dawned on me at the time that I have used ever since, and some of you have heard me talk about it. The question is, what did his behavior mean to you? I had to ask the veteran, what did his behavior mean to you? Because to me it meant that he was clearly not willing to let her separate, that he was a mean man. She said, he's a deacon in our church. He never lies. He has, he's got principles that are commendable. He's a man of great ethics. He is violating the very essence of him by going out and telling these lies about me. He's doing self-destructing, but in the process of his doing his self-destruction, his compromising, his whole being, he is telling me that he's willing to take me out psychologically. He's willing to cast me in this life that is just not me, and it will certainly be, if people believe him, they certainly are not going to want to help me. So he's really trying to get me psychologically, if not physically. So I said, yes, that's That's good, but that's sort of theoretical. It's not, I didn't say it that way to her, but I'm saying it to you. It's not that compelling. I'm not going to get so many of these police officers that I need to help you convinced that he's going to kill you. But, so she told me another story, and this one was that her husband reviled guns. But the week before, at the restaurant that they owned and ran, he pulled a gun from out from underneath the counter and pointed it between her and a customer, and then gave her, you know, this long, hard stare. And so my conclusion are, is this guy is likely to get himself in trouble with the cops, he's going to lose business, you know, all the things that are quite obvious about what happens, what are the consequences of this behavior. But I asked her, so what does that behavior mean to you? And she said, it means to me that he has the means of killing me. This man cannot kill me up close and personal. He cannot strangle me. He cannot suffocate me. He cannot use his hands. But a gun in which he can distance himself from me, he has the means to kill me now. And I'm very frightened. So I said, that one I think is a little bit more compelling. And so I can use that. We went through a number of other, she told me that he was considering suicide. And I asked, what did that behavior mean to you? And she said, he's thinking about killing me. So she understood the meaning and the intent of her husband in ways that were not obvious to the world. Now, those of us who've done research, who've been in this field, understand the risk that suicide is a risk marker for homicide in the context of domestic violence, but we didn't then, but she did. And so we were able to get all of this, get the cops to follow him, to stop him when he did some bad traffic things, and to remind him that if he violated the protection order, that they were going to do their very best to get him arrested and confined, etc. So that we had this whole network that was protecting her. And one day, he showed up in the morning in her car, with the loaded Beretta in the front seat in his puke, because he was drunk, and with a letter that said that he couldn't live without her. Well, we got him arrested for violation of the protection order. The judge did a nice job of setting very high bail. This was a protection order, so he didn't think he could set no bail for some reason. Although his attorney would not bail him out, his boss bailed him out. She was very frightened. She said, I've got to get out of town, help me get out of town. We've got her out of town. There was a letter that he sent to her mother that asked her to meet with him at their house at noon on his 40th birthday. She never got the letter. He killed himself in their house on his 40th birthday at noon. This woman saved her life, and she was able to convince me, who was a sympathetic person, to convince other people who were less than sympathetic that she understood lethality, potential lethality, and that we needed to up the interventions that we were involved in. And so I wrote this up, it's like 10 or 12 items, and it was a note that, or a form that we gave to responding police officers, asking them at every 911 call to review these items that she had shared with us. Not surprisingly, all of those items were on Jackie Campbell's dangerous assessment research, and all of them were risk markers that with the multiple level of risk. And so I learned this from Battered Women, and Jackie's stuff nicely confirmed it. And we can use those together in order to advocate for Battered Women in extraordinary ways. Next. I want to talk about Ed Gondel for a second. Ed is a great friend of mine. He's a researcher. He's done great work on battery intervention services. He invited critical discourse by inviting Ellen Pence and Oliver Williams and myself. And if you don't know Ellen, she can be one of the most, she has since died, but she can be one of the most critically thinking people that we know. And Oliver was no lightweight, and I was just an agitator. But he invited us all out to sit with him and talk about because he got this big grant from CDC who's new multiple site battery intervention program evaluation. What did he need to do that he wasn't likely to do? And we said, you need to change your measurement of success. You know, not getting picked up by the police again, not getting arrested, not getting, you know, put back on probation, that's not good enough. You have to know that the battered woman, the woman he battered and any partner that he has had subsequently are safe, and that their well-being, in fact, is improved as a consequence of having been in this program or been to go through the criminal justice system. So come up with some measures, ways to measure success from the perspective of battered women. None of the other researchers at that time ever thought about success being safety and well-being of the injured parties. So he did that. Something else we suggested to him, that we wanted him to compare the standard group with specialized group, race, culture, language groups, and he was able to in a subsequent, he had many studies that followed this bunch of studies that he did, look at dominant culture versus an African-American group. And evaluate that. I must say that although he did that, nobody else has really picked this up, and so we don't have culture or language or racial evaluations of battery intervention services, the dominant methods that we're using. The other thing that we said to him is that inclusion of smaller, less resourced, more rural, which is the bottom of the slide, sorry, I didn't change that, a bit, because we can't assume that it will work in Chicago will work in Orono, you know, to pick a larger jurisdiction in Maine, let alone some places in the county or someplace really rural. We need to know what's going to work in rural places. And so he agreed to try to do that. The CDC wouldn't let him do it because statistical measurement became impossible when we had such a small, you know, in. So we are still waiting the day where somebody will be able to evaluate. We're closer in Duluth, and I must, for those of you who work with Duluth and bring Duluth here yearly, I appreciate that, because they are working in rural places, and they have not done research, per se, but when I was arguing in my agitating way, that they had plenty of data. They could go to the criminal justice system, which is their great friend, and have them pull out recidivism stuff, at least. And they can see about mandating to their program and give me 10 years worth of data so that I could say that Duluth, using those very crude measures, works. And so they did. And Duluth works. And they have better longitudinal data than anybody else about that program, that model. I'll get to the controversy about that later. So we did another, a very interesting project when I was in D.C., the Scholars Against Native Women Guide for Practitioner Action, about 15 years ago. We were doing this for OVW, and because we knew that there were some significant lessons about critical conversations, we were very careful that we addressed them, that we asked all the participants to be committed to critical conversations in which there would be disagreements and they could be sharp, that they would be respectful, that we would be flexible in our approach to evaluating the document that we were developing, rather than sort of saying, this is it, tell us what the, you know, our grammar is off here. We really wanted to be flexible in terms of our approach and agenda in evaluating this document. And we wanted to trust this process of critique, conciliation, and knowledge production. And it's sometimes not easy. We anticipated some likely issues within the advisory group that we were inviting. There were historical tensions. There are historical tensions between different tribal nations, cultures, between the federal government and all tribal nations that I know of. The one big thing that we didn't anticipate well enough was that our understanding of Native history comes from law books. And the understanding of many Native Americans comes from law books. And law books are written by white men. And they do not fairly recite, document the history of Native American history. And so we are concerned that we were historically accurate in this. We knew that there were conflicts between scholars who know better than everybody else and attorneys who are superior to everybody else. And we needed to make sure that as we were putting this together, that we anticipated this and it wasn't going to take us by surprise, and that everybody had profound trust issues with the federal government, wondering that if we put together something that was correct, they would publish it. Or we wanted it to see the light of day. So what we did, we had one writer who was a very experienced scholarly attorney and one who was a very young attorney, both from non-dominant tribes, not the Northern Plains or the Southwest, but from smaller tribes, so that they didn't have the kind of vested interest in hierarchy, if you will, among Indian nations. We had me edit because I'm a decent editor and I take other people's stuff fairly well, and that we wanted to respect them so that they were going to become the facilitators of the meeting that we convened with all of our advisors. So our advisors were incredible. There were 30 or so, and they were tribal judges, policy wonks. They were all people that you see up here. Just incredible people. They were from 22 nations. I mean, it was the largest diverse group that had been gathered among Native American people to look at legal issues. There were people from 280 states, and there were people from states in which the tribal courts were the legal arena in which justice was meted out. All were volunteers. We thought it was just fabulous. And this is, you know, can't do better than this. Probably good, right? congratulations to us. Well, the night before we were all to sit down, all 30 of us, I got this call from a friend of mine, and she said, "They hate this piece of shit that you've written." I said, "They hate it. I think it's so good. These women worked so hard, and you know, these are my staff, and I need to protect them. I said, they have done such an incredible job. How can you possibly?" But she said, "Barbara, there are problems, and there are many problems, and they are different problems. And you've got to be able to figure out how to handle this with all these 30 people who are not rejoicing with this project." And so we did switch off, and I became the facilitator because I can be both diplomatic and heavy-handed. And we set up some rules that we weren't going to speak to people individually. We weren't going to create dyadic sort of relationships. They were going to have the whole group, was going to talk to the whole group. And they were going to talk in work groups. They weren't going to sit with their own, only sit with their friends. They were going to sit with other people that they didn't know, and they were going to continue to rotate. And that we were going to get report backs that were respectful, and that I was going to do my best to be respectful but firmly facilitate. So it looked like we were dead in the water, but it worked. It absolutely worked. You know, thank goodness it worked. But also, there's something about engaging people that you know are going to have different perspectives, asking them to give you the worst and the best of their perspectives, and then talk it out and create a product that was quite wonderful. Besides having gorgeous graphics, you would have thought the cherry had done this thing almost, but it was very well received, and the feds didn't stop it. And so this to give you an example of the importance of engaging people in critical thinking and taking them through a process that sometimes is really uncomfortable, but gets you, you don't quash it, you don't squash it, you know, you invite it, because otherwise it just sits under, and it in fact, compromises the work you're trying to do. Two brave people, next slide, Barbara. Oops. Two brave people who developed the Duluth model, the curriculum, the Duluth model, Ellen Pence and Michael Kamar, invited a group of us from Emerge, Susan Schechter, me, to come to Northern Minnesota to look at their wonderful new curriculum they had developed. Now, they knew they were going to get hard criticism because it's us. They're friends. And so, you know, we knew the process was to be respectful, et cetera, et cetera. We were not to talk behind their back. We did all that stuff. The issues that we anticipated, you can anticipate that there was going to be buy-in and turf issues because there were people, other people doing other batteries programs that were evaluating this. They had different models. We wanted to be able to establish some kind of leadership with governmental agencies so that they would listen to us and not approve medical or governmental models of better intervention services. And all that stuff we knew was going to be hard to do. You know, it was just going to be hard. But there were issues that we did not anticipate. And we got there, and I said, we've got to totally rewrite this thing. I mean, this is not just, we can't just pick it apart. It has to be rewritten. I mean, you're talking about anger management. These guys don't beat their partners because they're mad. They beat their partners because they want to assert, maintain dominance and control. And they certainly may get angry in the process of asserting their control, but it is not the anger that gets them to the violence. So, why are you doing this? I mean, anyway, so we also said to them, have you gotten input from battered women? They said no. So we said, okay, you got to scratch this. You've got to go to input from battered women, and you have to make this power and control based rather than anger management. And they did it. And they still talk to us. They still are dear friends. And so they did the rewrite. They have developed a very good structured curriculum that I was just jealous of. They talked to battered women. They created the power and control women wheel that you have seen in a zillion iterations for almost every issue known to humankind at this point related to violence. And we got buy-in from the battered women's movement, which is not to say that everybody in the battered women's movement loves Duluth, but that in fact it's probably well, at least in terms of folks that I know, it is a model that is well used. I know in this state there are two models in the that you all have a little disagreement about those models, but this is the one that we were reviewing, and that's what I'm talking about. Okay, so then the other thing, so you have to have a critical mass of people oftentimes, and critical abundance of agreement about something in order to get it to move. And so one of the things that, we did, and I can make these notes that I'm going to have to stop before I get through them. We needed to build this sort of critical mass of people, and we need to build this critical body of knowledge if we were going to be able to move the agenda of violence against women, particularly domestic violence, forward from a feminist perspective. Otherwise, we're going to lose it. So all those powerful people out there who had a vested interest in getting all the money and the power and glory, et cetera. And so one of the things that happened was that in 1978, the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights created hearings on domestic violence. And all the people who spoke were all those people that we didn't particularly, we liked them, but they were the doctors and lawyers and government people. They were not the battered women's movement. But we knew it was happening. 100 of us came to hear what they had to say. And when Donna and I said none of us were speaking, we met in the women's bathroom. We were in the commerce department, very large bathroom, nice tile, clean floor. And we there established the National Coalition Against Domestic Violence. At that point, 1978, there were many states that had state coalitions, but not all. But this call to organizing, I think, expedited the creation of state coalitions. Within a year, the membership of NCAAD included all of the extant coalitions, and I got appointed as the first legislative chair of NCAAD. And I was supposed to be monitoring federal legislation and policy, et cetera. And as a consequence, we heard about the Attorney General, let me go back. Oops. I'm not going to go back to this, waste time. We heard that the Attorney General was going to appointed task force that's going to have hearings all around the country on domestic violence, and then this is going to inform the federal government about what we're going to do about domestic violence. So we said, we have to make sure that what comes out of those hearings is our message, our knowledge, not the knowledge of the people that we heard at the commission. Of course, many of them very nice people, but they're going to eradicate this battered women's movement and substitute it with a medical approach to ending something that is not a medical problem, my perspective. We got met in Philadelphia, and there were about 25 of us, and we were mostly from the Northeast, and we developed a model policy and practice guide for how criminal justice systems should respond to domestic violence. These were in the days before laptop computers, where we took all our notes in writing, and when we had to take all the notes from all these little small groups that were working on different pieces of this and put them together and edit them. So I got to do that along with Jennifer Yansky. And we then sent our document out to all to the veterans programs in all of the cities where they were going to have hearings. And we asked them to make sure that they got on the hearing list, and that if there were multiple veterans programs that were on that list, they'd get together beforehand and figure out what each of them was going to say, that they supported what the others were saying, that they didn't get redundant. They asked battered women to offer testimony, and they get back to us about what happened. So what happened was they all got to testify. They all presented what we had created, and basically that 1984 Attorney General's Task Force report was what we had done in Philadelphia, that had the imprimatur of the Attorney General on it. So that's the idea of creating creating power where we had power vacuum, and where we as women, particularly and grassroots people, were not going to get any place out doing organizing and developing our constituency in a very powerful way. So what I can tell you is that the Attorney General's report was used, I mean, really spurred the passage of the CLIPSA Act. And for those of you who are domestic violence program-based, the Family Violence Prevention and Services Act was the first federal funding that paid for court services and shelter of domestic violence programs. And it was just instrumental that the Attorney General was so supportive of what we were doing, and therefore we got no problem with Congress. And we passed piece of legislation that has to this day still been the provider of monies, federal monies for core services. So we got the messages, we got the up messengers, and we were able, and from then on, I mean, we every piece of legislation that's gone through, some of us in one of the many organizations, NMEDV being one of them, Julie's with, and probably the lead on many pieces of federal legislation in terms of, and also the reauthorization of the Violence Against Women Act, just an incredible presence and power in Congress and in this, well, it used to be in the state, and sometimes it wasn't when Julie was here, but anyway, we're going to have it again in the state, I promise you. That's the hope part of it, okay? There was another, I'm now do some bad mouthing of researchers. Now I'm going to be done because I can't get through all these slides and you all have other things to do. In the mid-1980s, the UNH was having its International Family Violence Research Conferences. And those were really conferences only for researchers. They were not interested in practitioners coming. And I will tell you a story about one of the people that you would recognize today who was a fabulous researcher, was told that, in fact, she wasn't really a researcher because she didn't have a PhD in sociology or criminology, but in something else. So she was not allowed to be a presenter at this conference. Well, they didn't want us there either, the agitator, advocate, the batters program, veterans programs. But we registered, and we came and said, we are here to articulate our disagreement with the conflict tactics scale, which had become at that point already the dominant method of figuring out prevalence of domestic violence. It did not talk about domestic violence. It talked about individual acts of violence. It didn't talk about injuries. It didn't talk about sexual abuse. It didn't talk about sequencing. It didn't talk about context. It didn't talk about all the things that we knew were integral in terms of a rich understanding of domestic violence. And we wanted them to do something not to forsake that tool and develop another one that we liked, but if they weren't going to do that, at least they need to modify it to include all the things that I just said. Well, they were not happy that we were there. We asked to have the opportunity to speak, a sort of rebuttal in all of the sessions. They said no. We asked that they switch the agenda, remember that flexibility thing, and let us have a plenary. They said no. So we spoke at each, we divided it up, we went to all the workshops, and we all took on. In all of those workshops, where they were talking about all the things that we thought were undercutting the interests of battered women. And then there was a plenary session, and Larry Sherman, who some of you may know, he did the Minneapolis the police study, in which became the, which went like wildfire. It was one of the first pieces of research that was out of a scientific community that was highly respected in the criminal justice side of the scientific community. And Larry got up in one of the plenaries and he said that, first of all, he said that Batman's movement was resistant to any kind of research about the effectiveness of shelters. And it just wasn't true. Nobody wanted to evaluate the work that we were doing. And we weren't interested in them doing that, but we were interested in other people doing that. And he said, well, he proposed that it would be an excellent piece of quasi-experimental research in which you would randomly send battered women either to a hotel room with no services, or you send them to a shelter with core services and advocacy, and you figure out which model is more effective. Well, you know, I jumped up and was, you know, as controlled as lawyers get to tell them that that was just the most foolish idea. It was reprehensible, it was unethical, and blah, 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 through the whole agenda of why it was wrong. We thought nobody was listening, but the interesting thing was that after we left UNH, we began to hear from researchers around the country who were interested in talking with us about what are the research questions, what should be the research agenda, how should we engage in this research, how could we spread the knowledge beyond juried journals, help us figure out how to do our research. And the ed work that we did that I talked to you about happened after this. The flood of inquiry, the responsiveness of the research community, and it's not that it started robustly, but it's grown. And there are certainly in many of the research institutes around the country that look at domestic and sexual violence, they are clear that they need to engage us and other women in figuring out what questions need to be answered and how to have them answered and then how to get those messages out. So we were not well received, but we were incredibly well received. And so the contradictions when you are a prickly agitator can be fairly significant, but I think that if you trust the process and that you believe your messages carry with them truth, that in fact it may turn out that other people are convinced of the validity of your perspective. And that happened for us. And as a consequence, and we didn't keep going to UNH, but I don't know that the advocates go so much, and I think the same old practitioners, the same old researchers go, except that Sherry Handy is there now, and she is the one who took conflict tactic scale 2 and added sexual assault to it and did a cleanup. Not a cleanup that would make me happy, but it was a good cleanup. Okay, we were supposed to be done by now, right? Let me do lesbian battery. This is how we keep going. I got them. So, this is about me. Some can create knowledge. I think I can do that. Some can design strategies for knowledge delivery. I'm pretty good at that. Some can convey and market knowledge. I'm not very good at that. But the two people can do all of that stuff. So I wrote a paper on lesbian battering in the mid-80s and got all of my feminist friends and my lesbian feminist friends very angry at me because they thought I was rejecting a gender-based violence analysis of domestic violence. But I felt it was necessary to do this paper because otherwise the lesbians who were being battered were invisible and were in such incredibly dangerous situations because of the homophobia and the discrimination that they experienced in their lives otherwise, and the incredible danger it was for them to come out. Somebody needed to come out and say it was happening, name the violence. So I wrote this paper. And then after it was written, we decided we put out a book, and NCADV put out the book called Naming the Violence. And I got us the folks to write and wrote several things in it. And then it dawned on me, I don't want to be the messenger. I don't want to be the messenger. I'm such a Pollyanna, moving from one issue to another because I just love things that are new and things that pique my interest. I want to do. And there are other people who will follow through, who will develop, who will sustain, who will do an honorable, faithful, ethical job of bringing the issue of lesbian battering to communities all over the country and creating programs that are helpful to gay and lesbian, bisexual, and transgender people. I'm not the one, and so I bowed out. Now, it's sometimes hard when you think that was your baby, you know, to bow out. You need to bow out. You may not be a good messenger. We had another thing that's on this list of caller ID. This is something you all aren't probably paying attention to, except you work in a shelter and you want to make sure that you don't transmit your phone number to batterers or to the homes where batterers live, so that you might care about it. In Pennsylvania, the Public Utility Commission came to us, PCADV, and said, Bellatlantic is about to sell this great technology. It's wonderful. It's going to give people access. You know who's coming. You can protect yourself. Who's calling? You can protect yourself. You can block your phone number so that they can't read your phone number, but you can read their phone number. Blah, 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 blah. So we said there's some major privacy issues. The people who are buying your telephone services aren't saying they want to share their number with everybody in the universe. And there are people who are lawyers as well as bad women, as well as shelters, as well as any other organization that has confidential relationships with people. Do not want to spread that number around. You see, even on all websites that are related to domestic violence, people are warned not to leave cookies, to get off to get off that website, to hide the presence on that website. Confidentiality is key to better women. So, with the help of the Public Utility Commission, we figured out what caller ID was, call block, and all these other things. And we went to Bell Atlantic and said, you got to help us because you can't offer this product because we're going to fight with you. We will litigate, we will do whatever has to be done, but you can't offer this product without protections. And they said, what kind of protections? And so I worked with the head of public policy at the coalition on what we thought would be protections. I won't go into that right now, but I thought we had did a pretty good job. We also understood that what we did in Pennsylvania was going to, in fact, become industry practice. It wasn't going to be just caller ID in Pennsylvania. It was going to be caller ID in the United States and around the world. And so we had a very large constituency that we were trying to protect. And so that we had to be really tough women. Now, I don't want to be a little sexist here. Judy is the most well-dressed, attractive, mild-spoken woman in the world. She's a great messenger. A great messenger. Think about the people you think that do great messaging and that other people listen to. They don't listen to people like me. They listen to people like Judy. So she took the knowledge that we had developed, the systems, the protections that we had come up with, and she began negotiating with Bell Atlantic. And we got along pretty well, pretty far in that. I did not participate in most of that. And then it appeared that we were going to have to hire an attorney in order to get this thing done. And so she went out and she got an attorney, and she was able to convince an attorney to give very precious pro bono time to represent the coalition in our litigation against Bell Atlantic. And we prevailed. And we prevailed for the country, and we prevailed for the world, and it may not be enough, but it's a hell of a lot better than it would have been without our being able to do that. So it was a privilege to be able to create that knowledge and to be able to have that kind of cooperative relationship between the, Judy's also very good about developing the knowledge. I don't want to suggest that she wasn't. She and I together figured out what to do, and PUC helped also. But she would then became a great messenger, a messenger that they would listen to, unless the messenger that I think without her we would not have prevailed. So if it's your baby, whether it's lesbian battering, if it's caller ID, forget about your turf ownership, pride, da da da. If you aren't the best messenger, figure out who the best messenger is so that, in fact, you can create truth that will sustain battered women, sustain sexual assault survivors, and the movement that we are all in. That said, my time is up, I'm sure, and long time rule, so I'm going to stop. These notes that you, if you care to read them, we can make copies available to you on the website. This was recorded and will be on the website along with the PowerPoint, which doesn't say much of anything unless you fill in the blank. And I can make these notes available too. It's just been a privilege to make knowledge and to create movement and to organize for justice. And to see that the 40 years later, we are household, we are a household phenomenon. The knowledge that we have built is known not just here, but around the world. The UN is doing our work in nations everywhere. We are figuring out that the work is being done differently in different places, and as it should be. Just to say to you, I want to appreciate the work that you're doing. The tapestry of the people in this room, in the incredible variety of the work that we do, is situates us well for the next 40 years. I mean, you are the hope. You are the creators of knowledge and the messengers for the future. And so I hope you invite critical discourse about what you're thinking, and that you respect those with whom you disagree, and that you build movements instead of hoping that individuals will carry this because they can't, and that your children will then join you in this work, and we will in fact see the justice yearnings that we all had as kids and that we are still yearning for and sometimes discouraged about will come to fruition in ways that we couldn't even dream about. We couldn't have dreamed about being here in 1976 when we started the Pennsylvania Coalition Against Domestic Violence. And so I know we can do it, and it's yours now, and I relinquish it happily. You are the messengers, you are the organizers, and I look forward to having time with you from time to time in the future. Thank you very much.